space elevators, a necessary step towards the colonization of the solar system. Most of us have been on an elevator many times in our lives. You know that it's a pretty useful mechanical device for getting people or things up and down a building in a decidedly efficient manner. But have you ever wondered what would happen if we could build an elevator that could go all the way up to space? First wondered by astronautical pioneer Konstantin Tsiolkovsky, who in 1895, while contemplating the Eiffel Tower, imagined that his elevators could continue upward indefinitely. Science fiction? Maybe. But before making hasty judgments, it's always good to remember that in 1920, the New York Times openly mocked the early supporters of spaceflight, branding it as incredibly stupid. A judgment that, as the newspaper was forced to take back with an article of apology just on the evening of the Apollo 11 landing. Attention then that this of the space elevator is a technology that soon could really amaze us. The same Arthur Clarke who with his novel The Fountains of Paradise contributed in 1979 to popularize the principle. To those who asked him for an opinion on when it would be possible to realize such a wonder, replied, 50 years after we stop laughing about it. Since the beginning of the space age, we have not only mentioned one method of overcoming the gravitational pull of our planet, that of using rockets capable of reaching speeds in excess of 11 kilometers per second. Large and small rockets launched by controlled chemical explosions capable of carrying men and vehicles into orbit amidst puffs of smoke, deafening noise, and tongues of fire. In pioneering times, the thing worked, and with rockets we have gone to the moon. We have put in orbit a space station and launched thousands of satellites, but after the enthusiasm of the beginning, now we begin to understand that all this had an almost unsustainable cost. To put in orbit a mass of 1 kilogram costs, in fact, even today, the unacceptable amount of over $20,000. And in addition, it is uncomfortable and dangerous to have to deal with explosive chemicals. So we are looking around to find alternative methods, and it must be said that in the short time, all kinds of ideas were born. Launching rings, space cannons, magnetic catapults, all things we will talk about in another occasion. But once again, the most important and consolidated of all the ideas was the space elevator, on which NASA itself is ready to swear is the device that will reduce our dependence on rockets in the future, lowering costs down to a few dollars per kilogram of weight carried into space. On the other hand, sending people and cargo into space in capsules hurtling along a giant vertical cable has been described by scientists and writers like Clark. But until a few years ago, it was never considered feasible in the real world. So the question can only be this: are we deluding ourselves when we say that our technological capabilities will soon be able to overcome this truly gigantic challenge? Proponents of this very strange technology believe not. They see chemical rockets as an obsolete, risky, environmentally damaging, and exceedingly expensive means of getting into space. And what they propose is essentially something much simpler and more familiar. Basically a zipline moving along a cable suspended between Earth and a large mass acting as a counterweight, orbiting 50,000 kilometers away. The principle may seem intuitive, but how to do it in practice? Well, to begin with, the load-bearing cable should be made of, as yet non-existent, extremely strong but flexible material, with the right mass and density characteristics to support vehicle traffic and able to withstand an incredible amount of forces that tend to distort the whole system. For many years, physicists, science fiction writers, and visionaries have tried to enthusiastically calculate the size of these forces, only to be sadly discouraged by the result. Indeed, no known material is strong enough to cope with these forces. Not spider silk, not Kevlar, not even the stronger modern carbon fiber polymers. Let's try to understand more about it. The space elevator is a structure whose realization is still the subject of complex feasibility studies. If realized, it would have the ability to transport people and vehicles from the surface of the Earth directly into space without using rocket propulsion. There are several variants, all sharing the fact that, unlike a traditional elevator, it is not the cable that pulls the cabin, but is the ladder to move along the cable that acts as a guide and support. The fundamental idea is, however, based on the construction of a long cable that, starting from the surface of our planet, rises up to reach outer space. With its center of mass positioned at the geostationary orbit, are at a distance of 35,786 kilometers away from the Earth's surface. Cabins or containers driven by electromagnetic motors would climb up this carrier cable, capable of serving as mass transportation systems for passengers, cargo, energy, and raw material supplies between Earth and space. The realization of such a space ropeway implies the construction of a ground-based anchor platform, while on the other end, for the necessary counterbalance, would be attached to a large mass located well above the geostationary orbit, so that its centrifugal force exceeds that of gravity and helps to keep the supporting cable under tension. The mass of the counterweight needed for the purpose could be that of a small asteroid of about 10,000 tons, possibly to be captured and deflected to an appropriate orbit around Earth. To visualize this, imagine holding one end of a rope that has a rock attached to the other end and spinning it in a circle. Centrifugal force is what pushes the rock out and keeps the rope taut along its length. In a space elevator, the cable would be like this rope and the counterweight would be the rock. 4 to 6 cables, also called tracks, would then depart from Earth's anchor platform to connect transit stations located at intermediate heights. On the tracks would move electromagnetic traction vehicles, capable of reaching cruising speeds on the order of thousands of kilometers per hour. Such a construction would obviously be extremely sensitive to the violence of atmospheric agents, with a point of particular vulnerability in the crossing of the atmosphere. This veritable Tower of Babel would be dangerously sensitive to winds. Therefore, as an anchorage platform, it is suggested to use a float of the size of a large oil tanker or aircraft carrier to be placed west of the Galapagos Islands, sheltered from the areas where hurricanes and tornadoes usually occur, and with the ability to move a few hundred kilometers. Such a technology, according to many, requires the development of materials not yet within our reach. But whose realization could occur within the next 50 years, allowing the development of the space elevator project from the second half of the first century of the third millennium, with its completion towards the end of the 21st century? Perhaps an optimistic vision, but one justified by the latest innovations in material science. Many of the characteristics of resistance, flexibility, and lightness required would already be present in some special alloys already made in our laboratories, such as carbon fiber nanotube structures, similar to graphite with very high tensile strength, to be used for the realization of the load-bearing cable. To get an idea of what this means in terms of tensile strength, consider that a nanotube wire the thickness of a hair can even support a car. Other structures based on graphite, quartz, and aluminum are being developed and fabricated in various terrestrial laboratories and have revealed mechanical strength adequate for the hypothesized structural needs. More problematic, but not conceptually impossible, appears to be the realization of materials for the development of high-speed electromagnetic propulsion vehicles and the necessary connecting infrastructure. To get around all these temporary technological impossibilities, a different approach has been proposed by some. Instead of anchoring the cable on Earth, the idea might be to anchor it on the Moon and dangle it toward the Earth to geosynchronous orbit. The advantage in this case would come from the different magnitude of centrifugal forces involved. A conventional space elevator would make a full rotation every day, accompanying the Earth's rotation, but a cable descending from the Moon would orbit only once a month, with a much slower angular velocity and proportionality lower distorting forces. Moreover, these forces would be organized differently. Extending from the Moon to the Earth, in fact, the cable would pass through a region of space where Earth and Moon gravity cancel each other out, namely that of the Lagrangian point L1. And on balance, in this way, even the strongest materials currently available, carbon polymers such as xylon, could comfortably withstand the weight and stresses of a cable descending from the Moon to geosynchronous orbit. The savings would be enormous. It would reduce the fuel needed to reach the Moon's surface, and vice versa, to 1/10 of what it is today. We're still in the realm of future visions, it's true, but right now, Shizuoka University in Japan, the Obayashi Corporation, and the China Academy of Launch Vehicle Technology are all trying to find a way to build a space elevator within a few decades. About 2 years ago, engineers at the Shizuoka University created a scale model of one using two 10-centimeter satellites connected by a 10-meter-long steel cable. A small motorized container traveled along the cable, while cameras at either end tracked its progress. Based on the data obtained, scientists will determine whether the entire system can be safely replicated on a larger scale. The Obayashi Corporation plans to build a space elevator by 2050. This would involve building a 400 meter diameter floating anchor platform on Earth, connected by a carbon nanotube cable to a 1,250 ton counterweight in space. In contrast, the China Academy of Launch Vehicle Technology plans to have a working space elevator by 2045. Tsinghua University's research team has already developed a type of carbon nanotube fiber that is believed to be the key to creating a super strong cable. Chinese scientists have also conducted space tethering experiments, but without releasing details. It's true, all this may seem only a dream of the beginning of this millennium, similar to the grandiose and far-fetched futuristic visions dreamt during various universal expositions of the early 20th century, then revealed as naive illusions. The fundamental difference is, however, in the economic benefit, that is, in the incredible savings that such a realization could guarantee to the space agencies. Space colonization is in fact limited by the very high costs of the vectors necessary to bring in orbit the payloads. And as we know, in a globalized system like ours, the real engine of everything, especially with the recent entry into the competition by private companies, is the economic statement. Obviously, there are great challenges to overcome, just like those who built the first transcontinental railroad and the Panama and Suez canals, or those who in 10 years took us to the moon. It'll take a lot of time and money, but it will eventually get done. That is, unless something better and safer is found in the meantime.